to understand Nigeria, you need to appreciate where it came from.
In 1900, Britain officially assumed responsibility for the administration of the whole of what we now know as Nigeria from the Niger Company. And then, gradually over the years, British protectorates were established throughout the territory. In 1914, the protectorates were amalgamated into one Nigeria.
Actually, there's one additional detail that bears mentioning. In order to take over the territories from the Niger Company, the British government paid £865,000, a huge amount in 1900. So let's establish a simple truth. The British didn't travel halfway across the world just to spread democracy. Nigeria started off as a business deal for them, between a company and a government. Incidentally, the Niger Company is still around today, only it is known by a different name, Unilever. But that's another story.
Throughout these formative years, men of the colonial service were at work, patiently guiding the Nigerians towards eventual independence, introducing the elements of local government in villages, encouraging local industry, developing overseas trade, building a stable administration, preparing the ground for the giant strides to come. Nigeria is part of West Africa. It covers an area of over 339,000 square miles, nearly as big as France and Italy put together. Its population comprised half the people of all the United Kingdom dependencies. It is a land of many tribes and many languages, a land of differing views and differing people. The country ranges from desert on the edge of the Sahara, through the cattle grazing pastures, to the mineral hills of the central plateau, down to the coast and the swamps of the river delta.
Most countries are born out of shared ideals and common identity. Nigeria was simply created to fulfill a business requirement, that of supplying goods and services to Great Britain. With that backdrop, it was no surprise that after 50 years of colonial rule, Nigerians began to fight for their own self-government.
Newest visitors to London are delegates from Nigeria. Members of the Legislative Council, they want home rule for Nigeria's 20 million native population. Speaking about his trip, Prince Adedoyin says,
"We have come to the United Kingdom as delegates of the National Council of Nigeria and the Cameroons, chosen by our people, in order to demand for a more democratic constitution, to modify four laws affecting our lands, minerals, and chiefs, and to request the British government to grant us more political responsibility to enable us to take an active part in the management of our affairs within the framework of the British Empire."
These were the very distinguished Nigerians that the world was initially exposed to. They were proud, highly intelligent, and on a mission, both for Nigeria and for Africa. They granted interviews and gave speeches in full agbada, and people took them seriously. They wanted self-government, civil rights, and equal rights. They wanted to master their own destiny. They're actually about it.
And now Nigeria, which is the most heavily populated country in Africa. General Muhammad Buhari, who led the successful coup in Nigeria on Saturday, has now said that in the future, crooked civil servants would be put in jail without what he called the nonsense of legal proceedings. Other than radio broadcasts, Nigeria is still pretty cut off. The military men have cited mismanagement of the nation's economy as the reason for their move. They say that oil-rich Nigeria has become a beggar state. As Steve Shepherd reports, a bad economy was where this coup began.
Nigeria today owes foreign creditors more than $14 billion. Unemployment is rampant. Civil servants have been going without pay. Last year, in an effort to deal with rising discontent, President Shigari expelled some 1.7 million Ghanaians who had been brought into Nigeria as workers but began competing with locals for jobs as the economy started to decline. And last week, Shigari announced a new austerity budget which would have cut food subsidies and other government programs. That apparently was too much for the military, whose leaders believed Nigerian civilian rulers were not just incompetent but corrupt. It overthrew Shigari and promised to clean up the government. Nigeria's new leader, General Muhammad Buhari, is known to Western observers. He is considered intelligent, conservative, and free from corruption, a Western-oriented pragmatist. For that reason, U.S. officials have hope that the new Nigerian government will work to maintain good relations with the United States. Because of its influence in Africa and because of its oil, those relations are considered extremely important here. Steve Shepard, ABC News, the State Department.
Fraud, indiscipline, corruption, squandermania, misuse and abuse of public office for self or group aggrandizement, which had assumed debilitating proportions in the last few years, will be dealt with ruthlessly, no matter whoever may be involved. And I'm super bad. I got soul. And I'm super bad. The private sector has also its share of crimes against the Nigerian economy, especially in the area of the distribution of basic commodities. Reports reaching us confirm large-scale hoarding of commodities. I have already warned that hoarding will not be tolerated. Gentlemen, I must point out that your assignment as military governors is a service posting. You are therefore subject to redeployment at any time as the exigencies of our calling may dictate.
When Buhari said ruthlessly, he meant it. During the 41-year-old Major General's time in power, Nigerians came to understand what it meant to live in fear. With his partner, 41-year-old Major General Tunde Diago, a program to save the country was designed. They called it the War Against Indiscipline, with emphasis on war.
I want you to bear in mind the need to emphasize self-discipline and leadership by good example. Begin by drawing public attention to little but important everyday manifestations of indiscipline, such as rushing into buses, driving on the wrong side of the road, littering the streets, parks, and dwelling compounds, cheating, taking undue advantage of scarcity to inflate prices for quick monetary gains, constituting ourselves into public nuisances, working without commitment, and devoting little or no time to the upbringing of our children. Up to this moment, there has been no formal declaration of war against indiscipline. It is my pleasure, therefore, to declare today the launching day for the war against indiscipline.
The problems Idiago highlighted were real, and most of the solutions he suggested that day, including environmental sanitation days and queuing at bus stops, were laudable. The issue was how he and Buhari implemented their campaign. They pursued a brute force and highly physical campaign, which inevitably made them unpopular with ordinary Nigerians. People were locked up without trial, and anyone who criticized the government was ruthlessly dealt with. Politicians were arrested and detained without trial, in some cases for several years. A case in point was their bungled attempt to bring a gentleman called Umaru Diko to justice.
The diplomatic storm that's come up suddenly between Britain and Nigeria could be the stuff of comic opera, except that no one involved is laughing. Nigeria early today ordered a British airliner carrying 244 people to return to Lagos soon after takeoff. Only tonight are passengers being allowed to depart on other flights. In London, some officials are linking this act with a bizarre kidnap attempt that backfired. The victim was an exiled Nigerian wanted back home in the worst way. The plot began to unravel when a suspicious British customs inspector ordered some airport crates to be opened. As Tom Fenton reports, his suspicions were justified.
At least two of the three men found in crates with the kidnapped Nigerian about to be loaded on board this plane for Lagos last night are believed to be Israeli mercenaries. In one crate, the drug Nigerian Umaru Diko was accompanied by a man carrying syringes. He is believed to be Israeli. In a second crate were two other men, both fully conscious. One of these is also believed to be Israeli.
They were Arab-like.
Or Jew-like.
I beg your pardon?
Or Israeli-like.
Or Israeli-like, yes.
Middle East.
I think Middle Eastern would be the best general description.
A former minister and leading politician, Diko tops the new Nigerian government's list of most wanted men. In a country where corruption had become a way of life, Diko stood out for the scale on which he operated. The military regime, which took over 6 months ago, charges that he stole more than $1 billion before he fled the country. Diko's chief aim in exile has been to bring down the regime at any cost.
Any weapon that God gives me, I will use.
Yesterday, Diko was neatly hustled into a van by two men in the street near his West End London home. It was a smooth, professional operation, but it went wrong at Stansted Airport last night. The Nigerian High Commission had not properly labeled the crates as diplomatic luggage and also bungled the required paperwork. Diko is now recovering in a private ward under heavy guard. The new government so desperately wants him back, it may well have decided to go for the best and use agents from the country that kidnapped Adolf Eichmann. Nigeria's High Commissioner in London was summoned to the Foreign Office today, and there were lots of questions.
I'm not aware of that.
Tonight, there are still more questions than answers. Tom Fenton, CBS News, London.
Standing back and looking at that kidnap attempt, it was obvious that an administration that could organize and approve such an action had no respect for laws or due process. If Buhari and Idiago were allowed to stay in power, it was clear to their closest military colleagues that even they were not safe from brutal persecution. At the same time, the more ambitious generals who had helped to bring the regime to power had started to wonder why they were not running the country instead. Putting these two things together, it is no surprise that after 20 months in power, the Buhari-Idiago regime was overthrown in a coup arranged by their colleagues in the Supreme Military Council.
I know you can feel the magic, baby. Turn motherfucking lights down. Esco, what up?
What up, homie?
I mean, it's what you expected, ain't it? Let's go. Turn the music up in the headphones. Yeah, that's perfect.
During the reign of 44-year-old Ibrahim Badamosi Babangida, Nigeria hit new lows. Foreign debt ballooned to $33 billion. The exchange rate declined from almost 1-to-1 to 57 naira to the dollar. And corruption became a synonym for Nigeria. It's difficult to say whether Nigeria would have fared better if the Buhari-Idiago regime had stayed in power, as many external factors affected Nigeria's prospects during that time. However, it is clear that Babangida's ruling style, which was deft and tactical, seemed to be designed to ensure he remained in power rather than aggressively deal with the issues the country was facing. One should be fair to him, however. His initial messages and actions were very positively received by the nation, especially when compared to what had been happening under Buhari and Idiago.
I'm pleased to take this opportunity to declare once again, therefore, that this administration attaches the greatest importance to constructive and helpful criticisms as well as the freedom of the press, and to declare further that the administration also attaches the greatest importance of fundamental human rights. A visible improvement in the standard of living of our people will not come overnight, of course. it is nonetheless feasible to take a meaningful action now which would alleviate the deprivation and misery of the large majority of our population within a short time. Thus, the administration will, in particular, take measures to check our galloping inflation and soaring unemployment.
An interesting feature of the Bangladesh takeover of government was that he facilitated the entry into power of a new crop of officers. Unfortunately for him, many of these officers would try and take power from him over the coming years. But it wasn't only within the military that discipline had started to break down. The economic and moral collapse in Nigeria had forced ordinary citizens to find new ways to support themselves.
America is such a land of opportunity, it continues to attract hard-working, honest immigrants from all over the world. But law enforcement officials say at least one country is sending not only honest immigrants, but many who seek a different kind of opportunity. Bob Fall continues our special investigative series, Cons, Scams, and Ripoffs.
No African nation has more people than Nigeria. No other has more of its people visit the United States, and according to law enforcement officials, no other turns so readily to crime. Call it the Nigerian Mafia.
The Nigerians have become what we term in law enforcement an emerging organized crime group.
Meet Akeem Salome, shown here collecting some of the $28,000 in student loans he got fraudulently with eight aliases. That's right, eight.
Nigerians are active in procuring student loan fraud. They seem to be more active than other nationality groups.
This Washington, D.C. mother who didn't want to be identified is part of what police say is another Nigerian fraud. She got $500 to marry, then divorce, a Nigerian student so he could stay in the country. A scheme so lucrative, she went on to arrange dozens of quickie marriages for other Nigerians. Easy credit, city experts, has made it easy for Nigerians to rip off the system. Stealing carbon receipts or social security numbers, they apply for and get numerous credit cards, which they use to the limit.
I would characterize it a major economic problem.
Millions of dollars.
Millions of dollars.
Just from Nigerians.
Just from Nigerians.
And it's not just white-collar crime. Federal prosecutors say up to 90% of all heroin sold in the nation's capital is handled by Nigerians.
There is a large criminal element in the Nigerian community, sadly, that has devoted a great deal of time to heroin and cocaine smuggling into the United States.
No. It's not true.
The Nigerian government insists that 99% of Nigerians here are law-abiding. Many are victims, it says, of bias and sloppy police work.
They assume that any black man comes from Africa is a Nigerian. The fact that somebody is carrying a Nigerian passport does not necessarily mean he's a Nigerian.
If he is Nigerian, say students of the country, what he's learned is that corruption is a way of life in Nigeria which pays.
The most successful people in the country tend to be those who've accumulated their fortunes in corrupt means. And therefore, young people, students, and other immigrants take their cue from that sort of social structure.
I've had many Nigerians tell me they love it here because there's no country on earth like America. It's so easy to steal. I hear that over and over again. It's so easy.
The tough talk by Secretary of State Schultz while in Nigeria elicited a Nigerian promise to crack down on drug trafficking. But it will take more than words, say police, to stop Akeem Salome and all the others.
Despite the obvious and enormous risk, many Nigerians continue to engage in these criminal activities simply because it was a better option. At least in a Western prison, they would have three square meals, pipe-borne water, and uninterrupted electricity. For those not brave enough to enter this international crime scene, all they could do was stay in Nigeria and suffer.
Every day my people day inside bus. Every day my people day inside bus. 49 sitting, 99 standing. Them go pack themselves in like sanding. Them they faint, them they wake like cock. Them go reach house water no day. Them go reach bed power no day. Them go reach road go slow go come. Them go reach road police go slap. Them go reach
Richie Road Army go whip.
So free and smiling.
Then go look pocket, money no day.
So free and smiling.
Then go Richie walk where he ready.
So free and smiling.
Every day not the same thing.
So free and smiling.
Every day not the same thing.
So free and smiling.
Every day not the same thing.
So free and smiling.
With the state Nigeria was in, it was obvious that the military had not succeeded in rescuing the country from collapse. Corruption was still rife. Life for the ordinary citizen was worse than under Shagari, and Nigeria's external reputation was at an all-time low. It was clear that the military needed to go. So pressure was put on Babangida to begin a transition program which would hand power back to the civilians and create a third republic.
We don't want Babangida again, and we want MK home.
Who's MKO?
Abiola.
Back then, I also wanted MKO to be president. After all, he was a generally accepted winner of the Babangida organized and Babangida annulled Third Republic elections. It didn't matter that I did not know much about his policies, plans, or background. All I knew was that he was rich and gave money and gifts to everyone, even little boys like me. My views were illustrative of the attitude of the ordinary Nigerian back then. Expectations for a new government were low, and the focus was on electing someone who would not do much damage. A man as rich as MKO was, in our view, less likely to steal, and given his much talked about generosity, would continue to shower the ordinary citizen with gifts and promises. So it was simple. Give us MKO. But MKO was an unlikely savior. He was part of the establishment. His wealth was a direct result of his close ties with Shagari's government and the military after that. He had even been immortalized in a song by Fela.
I've written about ITT because they are the senior exploiters of this universe, of this world. I've had ITT stories all over the world, man. I've had the stories in America, in Europe, in Chile, all over. But I didn't know what ITT was about until I met MK Abiola himself. Then I see the evil, the kind of multinational evil they are trying to do.
Despite the questionable sources of Abiola's wealth, we still wanted him, and he knew it.
Challenge General Babangida to walk on any street of Nigeria with me, without security, and see how long it will take people, how long it will take before people actually lynch him. That is the type of leader that Babangida is.
It is still not clear today why Babangida and his supporters did not want to give power to Abiola, despite his obvious popularity and the fact he was one of their brothers in arms. Whatever the reason, the result of their actions was a worse outcome for Nigeria than anyone could have ever imagined.
Nigga X about me, nigga X about me, nigga X about me, nigga X about me. I'm a hustler, I'm a hustler, homie. I'm a hustler, I'm a hustler, homie. Nigga X, nigga X about me, nigga X, nigga X about me.
The takeover of Nigeria by 50-year-old General Sani Abacha is an illustration of the quote, "From the frying pan to the fire." Babangida's continuing denial of the presidency to Abiola had put him in an untenable position. He had become deeply unpopular with the public and had lost the support of most of his military colleagues. He had to go, and he knew it. So he went, but in his own special Maradona way, by installing a Harvard-trained industrialist and loyal ally to run what he called an interim government.
I, Ernest Adegunle Oladende Sonekan, do solemnly swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and that I will preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. So help me God.
But ordinary Nigerians were not appeased and continued to demonstrate against the interim government. Aside from the demonstrations, it was also clear to the man on the street that this interim government was completely unconstitutional.
Interim is interim. Interim, from the way I look at it, is not a democratically elected civilian government. Interim means somebody is handpicked. Come and stay here. That, in other words, means installation.
With the continuing backlash against the interim government, something had to give. And give it did. Babangida, as part of the creation of the interim state, had made an unprecedented move and appointed a soldier as Minister of Defense. That soldier was Sani Abacha. Abacha's job was purportedly to watch over the interim government. That was like asking a wolf to watch your sheep. After only 3 months, Abacha forced Shonekan to resign and finally took power for himself.
This regime will be firm, humane, and decisive. We will not condone nor tolerate any act of injustice. Any attempt to test our rule will be decisively dealt with. Long live the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
With those chilling words, Nigeria entered 5 years of brutal dictatorship. Abacha, unlike Babangida, did not suffer from a need to be liked. So he was particularly ruthless in removing all challenges and only surrounded himself with loyalists. His first target was Abiola, who had been going all over the country, declaring himself as president.
It will continue off and on until the military release the result of the June 12 election and put the democratically elected president, who is myself, in charge of affairs. I won't go to war. I won't encourage my supporters to go to war. I will fight for peace, and we will get peace. But you see, we do not want the peace of a graveyard, a peace whereby somebody continues to ride on the rest of us with a gun. We will get peace, but we'll get peace with decency and integrity and honesty and probity and democracy.
Abiola was eventually arrested from his home in Lagos by men from the secret police in June 1994. During his arrest, he made this call to the BBC.
What is happening at your house? Are you being arrested?
I'm being arrested. I'm just going out now with the police. And I was being escorted out to detention by singing the national anthem.
Why are they arresting you?
They are arresting me on an allegation of felony, nameless treason or something like that. They are not doing anything, they are just taking me away. Please let me go. You know, I'm delaying them.
And so where are you now? Are you in your car?
I'm in my car now.
Is it police who are with you in your car, or are they escorts? Are they
behind? Yes, the commissioner of police is in the car with me, and my senior wife is in the car with me.
Why are they letting you talk on the phone to the BBC while they're in the middle of arresting you?
They have come to arrest me, not to arrest my mouth.
You sound very cheerful about it, Chief Abiola.
Of course. You know... It's all part of democracy here.
And you're happy to go to the police and await whatever charges they're going to file against you?
I'm not in any way disturbed by it. Any sacrifice is in order if it will bring democracy, peace and prosperity to Nigeria.
Is it possible to talk to the Commissioner of Police who's with you in the car?
I don't know if the Commissioner of Police is authorized to talk. He cannot talk to the press.
What is your advice now to your supporters, many of whom we heard a moment ago?
Well, I told them before I left home to just stay calm. It is very, very important that they stay calm.
So you're appealing for calm. You don't want them to take any direct action in your support?
No.
You still say you're the president of Nigeria, but it's not much good if you're going to be in jail.
Well, Mandela was in jail for 27 years. Kenyatta was in jail. I suppose that is one of the qualifications you need in this part of the world. Don't worry yourself, my friend.
That turned out to be his last interview. Abiola would die 4 years later, still in detention. With the Abiola problem resolved, Abacha then turned his attention to his military colleagues. Having participated in several coups, he was acutely aware of the need to consolidate his power. So he was quick to arrest and detain senior officers, whether active or retired, including Generals Obasanjo and Yar'Adua. His final focus was on critics of his government. Anyone who made a negative comment, be they journalists or ordinary citizens, were detained by his secret police and tortured. A particular example was his execution of Ken Saro-Wiwa and 8 other Ogoni leaders, a story of injustice which has been well covered, so I will not replay it here. So Abacha's time in power can be characterized thus. I came, I saw, I destroyed. If Buhari had taught Nigerians the meaning of fear, Abacha completely redefined it for them.
My people say they fear too much. We fear for the thing we no see. We fear for the air around us. We fear to fight for freedom. We fear to fight for liberty. We fear to fight for justice. We fear to fight for happiness. We always get reason to fear. One child, my mother different house, my father different house. I won't build a house, I don't build a house. I know I won't quench, I won't enjoy, I know I won't go. So policeman go slap your face, you know go talk. Army man go weep your yash, you go they look like donkey. Rhodesia they do them own, all it does they have for nothing. South Africa they do them home. Them live sorrow, tears and blood.
Given the terrible state of the country under Abacha, it is not surprising that during that time, Nigerians found God in a major way. But some had better reasons than others for finding God.
People in Nigeria, Christians, I mean believers, I will give 80% the fact that they are running into Christ because that is the essence of living. Without Christ, there is no life.
How can you begin to say everybody all of a sudden is having vision? And in that vision is still one thing, that there should be pastors, there should be evangelists, and it stands to reason it can't be true. Most of these are fake, false, product of the society. It's more of a problem of hunger and famine in the land. Everybody wants to make ends meet.
There are self-type pastors, there are self-type evangelists and whatever name they want to call themselves. Even you've been hearing some of them calling themselves bishops, archbishops, but I'm yet to hear one of them calling himself Pope. Thank God. They draw people to themselves by claiming to work miracles. I think a lot of these miracles they claim, miracles in inverted commas, a lot of them are stage managed.
The Bible is about miracles. The whole of the book of Acts is the foundation of the church. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he worked miracles in those days, then he should still be working miracles today, and he'll work miracles tomorrow.
Well, in the end, God did work a miracle in Nigeria by carrying out his own coup.
The key oil-producing country of Nigeria is in a state of flux. Its military leader, General Sani Abacha, has died of a heart attack. Abacha was 54. Top officials of the West African country convened an emergency meeting to sort out the question of succession. Who will run this country, long kept under Abacha's thumb?
The passing away of General Sani Abacha was almost as momentous an event for Nigeria as gaining independence. It meant that, once again, Nigerians could resume their struggle for democracy.
The struggle of the Democratic Front against Abacha has not been against him personally, but against military dictatorship. And there is only one cause for the military to follow, and that's to understand that they now have a very graceful, very fortunate way of retreating to the barracks and allowing the will of the Nigerian people to go forward.
The military decided to heed Soyinka's advice. They appointed 55-year-old Abdul Salami Abubakar, one of the few generals who had risen to the top without holding political office, to lead the country back to civilian rule. Abubakar immediately released some of the individuals who had been under detention by Abacha, one of whom was Obasanjo. Obasanjo had these comments to make after his release.
The moral standard in this country has come down. That's one thing that shocked me when I was in prison. Even the people that you think will stand for principle, they just fall like a pack of cards.
Have you found in the short time that you've been out of prison that this is reflected in society at large,
yes,
that Nigeria,
yes,
is crumbling somehow?
Yes. Only very few Nigerians now stand on principle. They will go for whatever they can get. Materialism. And they will try to rationalize the what is not even rationalizable. We join Abacha because we think we could influence Abacha. And now who can tell you that he can reform devil? If it was possible for God to reform, he would have reformed Satan. And if God could not reform Satan, then anybody who thinks that he can reform an evil man, he's deceiving himself. He himself will become evil. And that's what has happened. Either voluntarily, or by association, or by compromising.
These are strong words you're using.
Yes, they are. But these are things that I believe.
Given the kind of comments Obasanjo was making, it was no surprise that he decided to run for president soon after, on a promise to clean up corruption and restore the moral standards of the nation.
We created an agency that will have nothing, that will, its job will be to seek, to search, and to recover, both from within and from without. And it will have a tribunal to back it up.
But the other candidate was also making the same promises.
So the first thing to do about dealing with corruption is to have a president and a government that is transparent and straight.
Nigerians have heard all of this before.
Since 1966, every successive government that comes in, the first coup was to deal with corruption in Nigeria. And every other coup, they've said the same thing, that the previous regime was corrupt and we are coming to clean up.
It was true that we had heard it all before. It was also true that the presidential candidates were all part of the regimes that had created the problems that now needed to be solved. It would be more a selection than an election, but it would still be better than military rule. So Nigeria went to the polls and ushered in the Fourth Republic. Ow! Ow! Woo!
I'm back!
In Nigeria, Africa's most populous nation, Saturday marked a significant government transition. CNN's Catherine Bond reports on the country's first civilian president in 15 years.
That as president
of the Federal Republic of Nigeria,
A historic moment for Nigeria as Olusegun Obasanjo, retired general and chicken farmer, was sworn in to head only the third civilian government Nigeria has had in almost 40 years. In his inaugural speech, he promised concrete measures to tackle corruption, which he said had brought Nigeria to its knees.
The beneficiaries of corruption in all forms will fight back with all the foul means at their disposal. We shall be firm with them. There will be no sacred cows.
Seated behind bulletproof glass at the ceremony, South Africa's President Nelson Mandela. He was among guests who also included Prince Charles. This transfer of power is seen by many as the most positive development on the continent since the end of apartheid.
The other transfer of power from Abubakar, the general, to Obasanjo, elected president, is as powerful as a shift from de Klerk to Mandela. And matter of fact, it's even bigger because in South Africa, 29 million people here, 130 million people.
It's no exaggeration to say this is a make-or-break opportunity for Nigeria. The start of a new civilian government, which, if it works, could create stability and recovery. But if it fails, we'll leave not just Nigerians, but many West Africans with little hope for the future. Catherine Bond, CNN, Abuja.
It is very pleasing to say that 8 years after that historic day, Nigeria is in a significantly stronger position. It was make or break, and we made it. Whether or not one gives the credit for that success to Obasanjo and his team, the facts are clear. External debt is now $4 billion from $35 billion. The Nigerian state now has a credit rating, facilitating access to international capital for Nigerian companies. Our foreign exchange reserves have risen to $40 billion from almost nil. The Nigerian stock market is up 900%, with significant investment inflows from both Nigerians and foreigners. GDP growth has been an average of 7% per annum, with a significant portion of that coming from non-oil sectors. New industries like mobile telecoms have been established with significant associated job creation. Foreign countries are even returning to Nigeria. There is an energy and vigor in the people, as well as return of confident expectation for the future. Probably most tellingly, Nigerians who left during the dark days have started to return home as they see better opportunities at home than abroad. In simple terms, Nigeria is back. It is tempting to end our journey on that high note and celebrate the full circle we have traveled, but we can't and we shouldn't. This film is about truth and balance, and if there is something Nigeria lacks today, it is balance. Nigeria's rich have never been richer, yet its poor have never been poorer. 55% of the population is below the poverty line. Sometimes those abstract statistics are difficult to grasp, so see for yourself.
Today I'm getting 1,800.
Just for the day. Is that your normal or is it better?
No, it's a special duty, so
okay, it's so a bit better than normal.
Yes.
Normally
I think it's about
1,400 naira is the equivalent of £7.20 per day or £144 a month. Henry VIII traveled to work and generally survived on that wage. But Henry was one of the better off people.
For a month, if you sell how much? For 1 month.
If you really know for that, I think 10,000.
If you sell 9,000 for the whole month?
Yeah.
Not enough money.
Safe, eh? Nigeria, you understand Nigeria is too hard.
Nigeria is too difficult, I mean.
It's too hard.
Thank you.
Uche made the equivalent of £40 a month, or £2 a day. It's amazing he could laugh at his situation. I couldn't. One can always argue that the cost of living in Nigeria is cheaper, so you shouldn't compare it to the UK. But the reality was earlier that day, I had visited a fast food place on Victoria Island, an equivalent of McDonald's, to grab a snack. That snack cost me 3 times Uche's daily earnings. 55% of the population are like Henry and Uche. That is not abstract or difficult to grasp.
It's just that the situation in the country now is very critical. You have to really go down, swallow your pride and do whatever comes your way. Yes, yes. You just have to put your whatever your qualification inside the cupboard, lock it up, and pick whatever job available to survive. That is just it.
Do what they can to survive, but their lives are still bleak. If things are bad for them, how do you think they are for their children? The reality is I don't see those children breaking out of that 55% poverty racket, unless they do it by force. And maybe they will one day, like in the Niger Delta. The Niger Delta situation is just the beginning. If inequality persists in Nigeria, we can only expect more. So I close this film with a challenge to all those who care about Nigeria and its future. We have a duty to leave a better legacy for our successors. We have a responsibility to create a nation we can be proud of. We need to return to a place where to be Nigerian is to be great, where everyone enjoys a minimum standard of life, where the accident of birth is not the sole determinant of your prospects. We need to take our rightful place as the greatest black nation in the world. I have no magic solution for how we do this, but I know two things. One, revolution starts with the individual. Two, right now, the wind is behind us. Thank you for your attention.
Desire in our heart. us now. Make Nigeria great again. I believe we can do it. I believe we can make it. I believe we can do it. Time is now.
Government in one African country, the whole of Africa will be liberated. See, we need one good government, a straight and progressive, clean government that knows what it's doing. No diplomacy, no compromises, yeah, no agreement, no Marxism, Leninism, no capitalism, Africanism.